everybody for coming, and I really do appreciate those of you who may be extraordinary ever, to be with us today. We're trying something different. We'll see how it goes, and we'll be looking for your feedback on how we can make it better. The town halls, are meant the real purpose of these things is to allow the command access to the command team. It is one of the things, one of the many areas in which I fail. I'm reminded of most days when I talk to somebody and I introduce myself to them, they say they've been here for a year. Some of that I understand is that there are a lot more of you than there are of me. But for me, that's a personal failure, right? And so what this does for me is it allows me to see some of you. But more importantly, it allows you access to me so thanks for coming tonight. Remember that this is an unclassified briefing, and normally that would be a big deal, but this evening we've opened this up, and there are a number of other folks. Hopefully you've joined us as we stream this live on Facebook. So again, thanks for coming. I want to thank especially our teammates here at Shaw. I appreciate you being here this evening, and I'll have everybody introduce themselves to you, just so that you know who's up here at the head table. But this is a really neat installation here, right? I was visiting with Wing Commander yesterday, and I told him that this is a very unique arrangement, and what we do here is not, this is based on a number of memorandums of agreements, and installation support agreements, things that we've signed off on. And I'll be honest with you, we enjoy the tremendous support that we do from Team Shaw because of the professionals that they are. Everything from, with a three-star general and headquarters, there's a lot of other stuff that comes along with that in terms of additional generals and senior NCOs. And the fact that, they make accommodations for us and really a number of different ways is not lost to me, and we're very thankful for. But this is a unique relationship. I was talking to some folks today and explaining some challenges that we have here. Challenges because this is not an exact fit. Because we fall under Air Force support here on Shaw, our flight memorandum, and our gracious hosts, and also under Fort Jackson. None of that is perfect, but tonight is an opportunity for you all to help us understand those things that the Sergeant Major and I don't see, so that at least we know about it, we can fix it, and something we can work towards in the future. Lorelai's not here tonight, she's down with a mom in Tampa, but those of you who know Lorelai, like me, I appreciate her focus on families. And I remember when I was a town commander, getting into this family readiness group thing, Lorelai telling the wife, "Hey, look, we don't run anything here, right? What we run are our families. Family readiness groups are commander's responsibility, and Lieutenant Colonel Garrett and the commanders are the ones responsible for the program." She said that we take care of our families. Probably not even a real requirement, for some of the things that FRGs do. And that's been her approach all along, and that has been focusing on our families and making our families stronger, more self-reliant, so that, our spouse soldiers can do the job. But we're always happy, and this is a great forum for us to talk about the challenges that we have. Talking a little bit about the differences, living on an Air Force. Again, it's not bad, it's just different. One of the things that I always tell you, if you go back to, my four priorities, one of them is communication. And at this level, we all have to be able to look one another in the eye and understand where we're either meeting or not meeting requirements and expectations. And if you tell me that, then maybe we can do something about it. But being disappointed you can stump yourself, not only does your service, but it doesn't help anybody else. And so, you know, this is an opportunity for us to share some of those. You know, every day in this headquarters, one of the things that makes us different is although we're sitting here in, on the east coast of the United States in central South Carolina, you know, most of us every day are in and out of the Middle East. You know, we are either because of some meeting or some civics or some requirement, you know, we are always bouncing back and forth between here and our locations for the challenge there is, you know, after 15 months of watching this, Sergeant Nick and I are actually talking about this today. You know, I know we got a standard for BT, right? We got a standard duty.
Basically that I know a little about plug real quick. If questions come up after this for the installation, again, please go to that through your leadership. We'll address them and get those questions answered. Additionally, internal secret every 3 to 4 months, hold the town hall as well.
Some of the things that have occurred since I've been here is that I've seen the HHP go out and participate in highway cleanup. I've seen us go out into the schools, and I've seen some of the children from the schools actually come here for arson and visit. So I think it was another shape of this activity is awesome.
What I'm telling you all is, I'm all about community support, doing things that I'm doing. We live here. So I wish I was around when we picked up trash outside the door. And actually wish we could pick up more, the community could all be here at the airport. Because that's something I think about 4 times a month. But being involved in the community is important, but it can't be outside, right? It's one of the things that I talk to folks around here about, things we can take on. If we take it on, we've got to have an eye towards the future and our abilities to sustain it. So that's the one thing that I would ask you. I'm not doing anything, but we can't just do it once, right? Because in that sense, service things, a different essence than we really did when we did it.
Thank you. Yeah, I work, sir. Quick question about the gym. I know on the main gym, we have 24-hour operations. I want to work with you for that for the annex. Is that something possible?
Yeah, that was something that we had at the Townhall before, and we had looked into that. Right now, based on the amount of usage that annex gets, there are no plans to open that for 24 hours, but I would say that it's definitely an issue that we're aware of.
I have another question from the webpage. Question is, the 441 gate closures are confusing and based on school schedule, not the post actual work schedule. Can we get the 441 gate time standardized?
A lot of them, the children are already moving on to college.
they may be here before, or they may be before Jackson. So it's very easy, but it's a matter of keeping the hand on the pulse and offering the help whenever available. But from my point of view, this is out of it. And since I got the microphone, I'll change the subject real quick.
But what it means to us is work.
That's where our shed has been since 1991. We established our first headquarters over in Quay, but this past meeting for everybody that's ever worn it is work. A lot of work, every single day. But you know, we need to, you know, at every opportunity, you know, remind ourselves of our vast story, history, and celebrate that. And I tell you, this is the first or the grandson?
The great grandson.
The great grandson, yeah. Well, you know, we are going to do something. I just don't know what it is yet.
Evening, it's Colonel Rydell. I'm the Chief of Civil Military Operations, finishing up my third year here at Fort Shawsome and 3rd Army. My wife and I particularly, it's gone a lot the first year. Can't commend the team over there at 20th Med Group anything possible, because the support's been just phenomenal. As two medical questions. First one for the 20th. With the shift to the new facility, is there any expanded capability or capacity, more doctor's appointments, more doctors, that we get to look forward to, since you're just weeks away from moving? Hold on. Then number two, over to our friends from Jackson, are there any unintended consequences of changes in the hospital at Jackson with rumored shutdown?
So in regards to creating transitioning from a hospital to a clinic, whether or not that's going to have a great impact on services, that's right. Okay. So there's not going to, other than, you know, we no longer have inpatient services because we're no longer a hospital or a clinic, that in itself is a great impact. All of those surgeries that once were being conducted at Moncrief are now going to the network. So they're being done at either Palmetto or whatever clinical setting or hospital have those capabilities. A lot of our surgeons have stayed either in-house, retired, gone elsewhere, or have gone to the network. Very few have actually stayed because their specialty has left. So that, again, is a great, a lot of active duty soldiers who require specialties or operations and things like that, a lot of them are being sent to Fort Gordon, who still have those capabilities in-house. But other than that, we're still seeing the same amount of patients in the clinic or appointments for your PCM. They're trying their best to ensure that time is being utilized to the best of their ability, so that appointments aren't being missed or no-showed or anything like that. Other than that, that's pretty much all the information I have for you.
Thank you.
Hey, that's a great question. Thanks. And here's Mr. Kinn. You know, you look at the chief staff of the Army Sparrow, you know, they haven't changed. Readiness, you know, our soldiers and the future of our Army or our families. And, you know, the Army right now, as we, you know, so think about it, for the last, I don't know how many years, 3-4 years, we've been producing. Some things different. You know, commissaries and, you know, Ambos restaurants and, you know, some of these other things under pressure. But I do know that they're being studied. You know, this, moving on to this new retirement, right? This new retirement system. You know, it's our attempt to want to move our system into the, you know, 21st century, but also to address, you know, one of the biggest challenges that we have in this country, and that is our debt, right? I mean, what we can do to reduce, you know, the big cost for the Army, and the big cost for the Army is personnel, right? So we're trying to figure out how we can reduce that to increase our discretionary spending. But this is all going to be, you know, based on what you all, what we, you know, as servicemen and families want. And so what happened in Fort Jackson is just the, you know, that is what happens when you draw down. Those are questions that people are asking about, okay, what can we do to be more efficient? How can we leverage capability that resides in our communities? And it's different for us. I think, you know, we're a little insulated here. I think we're living on Fort Jackson, and we were, you know, accustomed to, like we are in the military, going to the emergency room and you know, getting some of the other services. But no longer is this. And maybe we would react a little bit different. Here on Shaw, you know, there is no emergency room, right? And we go, I had my first experience with that, you know, a few weeks ago. You know, I had to go to save everybody else. I went to wherever the heck it was.
Good afternoon, sir. Major Trice. I have a question for you, sir. Considering the current DA civilian hiring freeze, do you think or do you anticipate RCIF will receive an exception to policy for that DA civilian hiring freeze, considering civilians are a large part of our workforce? And what risks do you anticipate as a result of not receiving that exception to policy in regards to the DA civilian hiring freeze?
Yeah, there may be some that can provide more details. I actually saw the Secretary of Defense's letter this afternoon. It gave a little bit more detail on, you know, the hiring freeze and how we would apply it to the DOD. So, you know, somebody in the G1 is digesting that. But here's kind of how Eric feels about this. This isn't new. I mean, we've had these kind of challenges before. And when I say challenges, I mean, these are decisions that our leadership is making. You know, it may not sound like good reasons to us, but I tell you, you know, we really have to, I mean, you know, our national debt and our costs, we've got to figure out how to do it. We cannot continue to do, you know, the same things that we're doing today. I think we're going to make a difference there. So, you know, although it will be challenging, I will tell you it is more challenging for other units than it is for us. You know, for ASCC, we don't have. It's just because we've not gotten around to it. We don't have the number of civilians that we either, you know, are authorized or quite frankly need. And we'll continue to work that. But, you know, I go back to my comment on our, you know, as long as we all are clear on what the priorities are, we'll make sure that the most important things get done, and the things that, you know, that we can push down the road are at the bottom of our list. Have you had a chance to ask if we can say something?
Sure. And it's really, we're taking a judicious fiscal response to how many ETPs are really we can honestly ask for, because there are very stringent guidelines on what you can ask. So right now we're looking four or five realistically ETPs, and as they reach more guidance.
sir. How do you know it's made by the GA? My question is, what the likelihood, I know we're trying to save money and everything, what the likelihood of us possibly having like a mini shop there or a clothing sale? Because I was had to go to like Fort Jackson and make purchase for military gear.
I'll let them talk about future plans. So I'll tell you, I've been there a couple times. I think the Air Force does a pretty good job of their clothing sales here accommodating our needs. And my guess is, I don't know this for certain, but my guess is that there's something that, again, I think communication is so important. If we're walking in there, and the item that we're looking for is not there, and we didn't tell anybody, shame on us. Okay? Because my guess is that, if we lay the requirement on the Air Force, they'll do their best to get it. I do agree with you, though, in terms of,
Air Force, they do have a plan for a shop at this master build plan, but we're probably 3 to 5 years away from that.
So I have another one from the internet. Person wrote that South Carolina is a concealed carry weapon state. So they ask, what is the clear DOD policy for concealed carry on base? Policy different from branch to branch and or base to base? Finally, what will Shaw Air Force Base policy be regarding concealed carry on base?
Yeah, I don't know about you. What I will tell you is Colonel Seeker's policy is there is no concealed carry on this installation. So they talked about, I don't know what they do in Fort Jackson or anywhere else. But I'm not familiar with any concealed carry authorization on federal installation. But I know it is here on the Shaw Air Force Base. And there is no concealed carry. Anybody else?
Sir, sorry to incur your attention. My question is about the education services we have here. When I'm processed and I talk to them, and they're great. I got to say, the counselors are excellent, but they can't really help. They can't really help our soldiers. Is there anything that is being planned to maybe have at least one Army counselor come here once a week so that our soldiers don't have to go back and forth to Jackson because the counselors here can't access the Army education system?
We'll take that on. We're currently in discussion with the garrison at Fort Jackson. This, general, this other before, but we'll definitely take that on.
If the Army seems here is completely different than the Air Force, so they cannot access the
that's a good point, Sergeant Major. There are a number of things that Fort Jackson extended to us here at Shaw that have been curtailed since I've been here. I don't know if that's ever been extended here. I don't know why we wouldn't be able to access it from our Army networks. Maybe that's something we can do.
So actually, there's a few issues like that. So education is one. Transition services, other things like that. So I think as we look ahead, our finance who comes down for Jackson once or twice a week, or I think it probably something similar to those lines where we get. So Jackson maybe come down on a specific day, to offer services. Again, the hard part with that is, is coordinating with all the soldiers that come to get for that, specific.
You guys do this stuff, and I'm not even here most of the time. But an approach would be, because again, it is coordinating, and an approach would be, weekly, monthly, pulling all the folks to the department, putting them on the bus, having the right supervision, and taking them on. up before Jackson and getting that stuff done. And that may be, you know, an approach. As opposed to what I think we're doing right now, I think what we're doing right now is, you know, Park Garrett or Southern Garrett, you know, drives himself over to Fort Jackson.
Major Captain Jackson, HSC Commander. I wanted to discuss, if possible, so I'm one of those personnel that are running around when it's dark, and I was wondering, is there plans to light some of the lighting, the running trails that we have around here? Because it's extra dark, and with the time changes, it's really unsafe, and our reflective belts kind of reflect, but not often. Also, we have the, just from my foxhole, we have the soldiers at the time with their children in daycare. Is there going to be possible extended hours for extended, like, exercises or something that we have so that they can have a few more hours of work, if possible?
Still exists. You know, a lot has changed since 2011, a lot.
But the chief is putting this together, and that's going to help us, refine our requirements for what we want to hear on this installation. We go back to Fort Jackson and make sure that we can negotiate the requirements, that we have for our soldiers and families here. We're going to need your input. Right? So if you feel strongly about something, make sure that you work it up to your chain of command so that we can address your concerns. Great question.
Major Crenshaw from Duke. Looking at the base paper, we see that Shaw looks to be a great location for new Air Force units, maybe a squad, maybe a group, and family members. Question one is, when can we expect that influx of people, and do we expect that infrastructure will keep pace, gates, facilities, and what have you?
So the Air Force will select Shaw as the preferred location for an MQ-9 recruit. Right? So that does not mean right now it's a done deal. What that means is that it will now go for an environmental assessment. I think it was that we have to pass. And once that environmental assessment is complete, then that will allow the leadership to go to the Air Force to then choose. That MQ-9 group will be about 430 personnel plus dependents. There will be no airplane associated with that, just the mission control elements, just the room they sit in, they're going to control those aircraft and run the load. The timeline for that is aggressive. The commander of Air Combat Command is pushing to have funds.
Sun Brigade, also known as the RSEN gate, is currently open 0600 to 1800. Is it possible to add an hour on either end?
Thank you.
The housing has also downsized because the building housing was 12 to 1500 homes. So we don't have the ability to support a geo-bachelor type. If you're designated personnel, or if you are community personnel, then of course we house that community here. But our government housing, that's our partner, and Norma Cross will be staying and speak to that, she accommodates and helps the certain number of people without a family.
We don't have the we only have this, like you said, the 633 units, and so we can only house those folks who are families. But then we do try, the housing office on the government side, we do try to provide a roommate situation for folks that are separated from their families. So we try to, you find an apartment, you come in to us and let us know about it, and we'll try to find somebody to match up with you. But right now, there are no plans to build any more units or two
houses. Do we have, last year, understand, you know, what's important to you. Any thoughts and ideas that you have would be helpful.
This is my topic. I just came from Korea and looked at AFN, and in Korea they have like AWR funds, so when you mentioned like social events, would some of the event be something that people do?
What do you mean? Have you invited somebody here?
Yes, sir. For instance, while I was, the last celebrity event we put on before I left Korea was the rapper Nelly, and the St. Olympics came out and did a free show, so something like that.
Yeah, I think Nelly, I mean, I think